This is a Sandler training audiobook, produced and distributed by Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, in partnership with Sandler Training. Bootstrap Selling the Sandler Way, or How to Own Your Career and Make It Flourish, by Bill Morrison. Narrated by Paul Woodson. We hope you enjoy this program. Note, because the English language lacks a generic singular pronoun that indicates both genders, we have used the masculine pronouns for the sake of style, readability, and brevity. This material applies to both men and women. Foreword. David Sandler once said, "It's the person who makes a decision that makes it successful, not the decision itself." Bill Morrison's new book offers a masterclass for salespeople in making good business decisions, and in being the kind of individual whose decisions consistently result in successful business outcomes. What Bill calls bootstrap selling is nothing more and nothing less than selling with a sense of deep personal accountability for one's process, one's word, and one's customer. Once those three accountabilities are in place, all kinds of amazing things become possible. This book shows how to create that kind of accountability, which the great salesperson and the great entrepreneur share. We find that the most successful salespeople, regardless of industry, are those who create a relationship with a coach who can serve as an accountability partner and help the salesperson track his progress toward important personal goals. No book can take the place of such a coach, of course, but the lessons in bootstrap selling that Bill offers here can definitely make that relationship richer, more productive, and more rewarding for both sides. If you familiarize yourself with each of the critical lessons in bootstrapping that appear between these covers, and if you work with a coach to master the behaviors, attitudes, and techniques that connect to each of those lessons, I can promise you that your sales career will move forward to a new level of productivity. Not only that, you'll become a better person in the bargain. David H. Matson, President and CEO, Sandler Training. Introduction. Good salespeople learn, at some point in their careers, the difference between simply doing the job and accepting the personal responsibility to produce certain results. This book is called Bootstrap Selling because it is all about accepting the personal responsibility for one's sales behaviors. You might have a large team around you, and you could have a great and supportive boss. But the difference between a self-starting, high-performance, bootstrap sales professional and an order taker is that the bootstrapper knows it is the critical 2% extra personal commitment and acceptance of responsibility that makes things happen. Bootstrap selling is based on the idea that all sales is entrepreneurial in nature. It is the salesperson who grows the areas of a business with which he is entrusted. The desire to succeed is only part of the bootstrapping ethos. Without personal acceptance of responsibility and commitment to take control, the best goals in the world are just words on a piece of paper. This book is a collection of case studies in which salespeople need to either step up or step aside in sales situations. Just like in the real world, not every bootstrap selling story has a happy ending. While success is a great teacher, failure is too. Red lights and green lights. The reality of selling and the responsibility it brings was something I learned early. Like many people, I came to sales from another role. When I got my first sales job, I brought my old behaviors with me. I had always been quite organized, and I had no problem with hard work. From day one in sales, I was out and about visiting customers, checking items off my to-do lists, mastering my product knowledge, and generally being a busy beaver. My first quarterly appraisal, therefore, came as something of a shock. My boss had seen my level of activity and hadn't been hearing any cries for help, so with other things on his plate, he had pretty much left my territory to me. When our review started, he pulled out my annual objectives and two colored pens, one green, one red. Traffic light pens, he called them. "Aren't there three colors of traffic lights?" I asked. "Not these traffic lights. In sales, things are either moving forward or they aren't. It doesn't matter why something has stopped. If it's not moving, it's not getting anywhere." With that, my boss began working through the list of sales opportunities I was expected to deliver. I noticed my boss was not making much use of his green pen. Almost every opportunity on the list was showing no progress, As he asked me what was happening with each item, I heard myself say the same phrase over and over again. I was waiting for the technical department to answer some questions, our finance department to approve a new credit limit, a new PowerPoint from the marketing team, the customer to run a trial. Every excuse was genuine. I had done nothing wrong, but item after item was getting a red light against it. It was the day I learned the difference between the words effective and efficient. My problem was that I had been accepting too many maybes, too many think-it-overs, and far too many will-let-you-knows. In my defense, I thought I was doing my job. I thought my mission was to run around presenting my features, advantages, and benefits, to be polite, and to keep my prospective customers smiling. The reality that selling is all about driving progression, that it is almost entirely dependent on generating decisions, came as a bolt from the blue. Clearly, I was not living the behaviors that made decisions happen, but I was committed to changing that. From that point on, I was on the path to becoming a bootstrap salesperson. It was not an overnight transition. That's an important point, one I want to be sure I explain solidly before I begin this discussion with you in earnest. It would be wrong to suggest that you can make this kind of personal transformation by pinning a poster to a wall or spending a weekend reading a book. In my case, it started with the acceptance that to achieve the success and self-respect I required, I needed to get help from those who were willing and able to coach me to the level I wanted to reach. Understanding neat sales techniques intellectually was one thing. What I needed to get to the next level was a combination of practical techniques and the human element that could turn those techniques into practice. I needed someone who would support me through the learning process. I suspect you need the same thing. With the support of some solid mentors, I found that by understanding the techniques that worked for me, by putting them into practice consistently as new behaviors, and by redefining my attitude toward my responsibilities, I could create a steady trajectory toward higher performance and significantly higher personal income. My performance turned around. I was happy. Just as important, my boss was happy. In fact, since I began delivering on my objectives, I was being increasingly trusted by my company with greater and greater sales objectives. In particular, my boss let me know, in his own inimitable way, that he thought I was ready to step up to a significant sales challenge. The next challenge. The company I was working for was multinational, with the sales teams selling multiple product lines. One product, I'll call it Product X, had never gotten off the ground in my region. The salespeople before me had always provided lots of great reasons why Product X hadn't taken off yet. My boss at that time was a man of few words. Toward the end of the annual planning cycle, he called me to his office and showed me a graph. The graph showed the tiny sales figures for Product X in my region compared to the company's other regions. "Bill," he said, "we have just had our global business review and I have made the commitment, on your behalf, that your region will have a sizable and sustainable level of business with this product within 12 months. Making stuff happen. My boss did not specify what sizable meant, and he certainly didn't tell me how to do it, but he made it crystal clear that he expected results. As I was digesting this news, he added a phrase that turned a nightmare mission into a dream challenge. "If you need anything at all to get this done," he said, "let me know." I felt as though I had been given a gold card to any resources I could imagine. I dived into the job with a vengeance, constantly repeating the mission I was on whenever I met an obstacle or a potential ally. Since my boss had given me a crazy mission, I had a great story to tell. The story and the goal that went with it resonated with almost everyone. When people saw that I was serious, a strange thing happened. Because it looked to everyone that I had a plan, people started signing up to help me achieve it. While it is a universal truth that if you are not working to your own plan, you're following somebody else's, it also rings true that if you have a story that sounds like a plan, you have a pretty good chance that people might follow you. My sales strategy evolved as people began to offer their advice and support. The main input from me was my constant focus on and repetition of the goal my boss had set for me. At the end of the year, we delivered business to my boss that was both sizable and sustainable. In fact, almost a decade later, that business is still thriving. With the benefit of hindsight, it is crystal clear to me the difference between my early failure in sales and later successes, the decision to accept the responsibility for business results and to create success as a bootstrapping salesperson. The investment in change. This is not to trivialize how much effort I had expended during those 10 years. Change does not happen overnight, and it takes more than a wish to make big things come true. In the 10 years between these two sales episodes, I had gathered a decade of experience. I had the benefit of a number of sales training programs. Several good bosses had spent time investing in giving me sound advice and good guidance, and, possibly most importantly, I had had the great fortune to see excellent business people in operation and had learned to replicate some of what I had seen them do. But even that was not the whole story. These things were all basically sales techniques. All across the world right now, thousands of people are sitting in sales training seminars learning some of those same techniques. For the most part, though, they will never generate value since they are unlikely to be applied. A huge amount of what you learn in a classroom stays in the classroom because it is not put into practice. It never leads to behavioral change. To turn great ideas into business and personal value, let's look at a simple model we at Sandler call the success triangle. The idea behind the success triangle is simple. Techniques are great business tools that help move you toward your objectives more efficiently. When you consistently apply these techniques, you have developed a new behavior. Once you make a real behavioral change, it leads to the experience and perspective to develop a new attitude. My own experience of learning how to sell was no different than that of anyone else. It revolved around a single choice, the choice to accept that I would have to change. Change meant doing things differently. Change for me is the same as change for anyone else. It revolves around understanding your comfort zone and then moving outside it. That means accepting that you need to get used to the idea of being uncomfortable. What it takes. A few years ago, professional tennis player Andy Murray had become the sport's most famous runner-up. He made a lot of finals, but did not pick up a lot of silverware. Then, within a few months, he had won the Wimbledon men's singles trophy and an Olympic gold medal. Of all the plaudits that flooded in, one really resonated with me. Andy Murray made himself learn how to do things that he did not enjoy doing. That may be one of the smartest summaries ever given of what personal development requires. The good news is that the payback is massive. Applying the new techniques you learn drives new behaviors. For me, the two critical behaviors I needed, but didn't enjoy, were a commitment to display shocking and disarming honesty, and acting on the concept that the human being I was talking to was the center of the sales relationship. I always had a lot to say, so slamming on the brakes and behaving as though what the other person had to say was actually more important than my sales pitch was a tough learning experience. Being open and honest enough to put my agenda on the table as being of equal value to that of the customer was something that also came as a real shock and was a tough behavior to adopt. But I did it. Attitude versus technique. Some years ago, the founder of the startup IT firm where I worked went on my first joint sales call with me. He was a sales nightmare. He argued with the client, spoke too much, rarely asked any questions, and spent a considerable amount of time explaining to the client that their strategy was plain dumb. Amazingly, the client adored him. Despite every apparent failure in sales technique that he displayed, his passion, honesty and joy in the subject was so transparent that everything he said sounded like music to the ears of the client. Years later, I learned the phrase, "Attitude beats technique every time." I knew it to be true as soon as I heard it because I remembered that man. One of the common problems with developing professional skills is a dependence on tricks and techniques. Sometimes people can learn to adopt new ideas in practice, but unless they address their attitudes, their core beliefs will rise to the surface again, and they will revert to their previous way of behaving. Many salespeople have had the experience of leaving a training course full of good intentions, only to find that within a few weeks, they can barely remember what was covered in the training. That is why you need to understand what the winning attitudes are in sales, The bootstrapping attitudes. Bootstrap selling attitudes. Think of any group of people you know, in any field of activity, and you will probably find that the group breaks out into three sections. Unfortunately, there is always a group at the bottom that is going nowhere. These people focus on reasons for failure, why they have been let down by their product, their company, the clients, or even the economy. They are non-performers and probably get what they expect to get, which is failure. In the middle, there is a group I call at-leasters. These people may not be at the top, but they wake up every morning thinking things like, at least I'm not totally failing, or at least I'm a little bit better than last year, or at least there are people on the team who will get kicked out before me. Their mission is to make sure they cover their back and produce enough to stay out of harm's way. Then there is the top group, the group of individuals who see all the same issues as the at-leasters, but accept that these problems are just a natural part of their business lives. Responsibility. The people in the top group accept that, regardless of the challenges they face, they own the responsibility to produce results. This acceptance of responsibility is far and away the number one attitude that good salespeople need to adopt. Bootstrap salespeople are likely to think, if it can be done, is there any reason I can't be the one to do it? What do I need and who can help me get it? They know they have a long list of tasks to complete every day, but they never lose sight of the basic question, what have I committed to and how do I measure myself? There are two parts to this, the hard measures of results and goals, which tend to be based on numbers, and the behavioral measures. These define the actions to be taken on a consistent basis. This is virtually the same as creating one's own personal corporate culture. Everyday bravery. It would be wrong to say that applying new techniques and turning them into behaviors does not require a touch of courage. In order to turn intellectual understanding into sales value, you need to apply a measure of everyday bravery. It's not superhero bravery. It is a small, low-risk, day-to-day type of bravery that allows you to step outside your normal limits of comfort to try a new thing. It could also be called everyday because you need to do it every day. If you go a full working day without straying into new behavioral territory or into a place where you are slightly less comfortable, then you have to ask yourself, am I on cruise control? The shocking thing about slipping into cruise control for a day or so is that you can wake up 6 months further down the road and suddenly realize that you have just dozed your way through half a year. The conscious effort to choose to do the tougher things has a payoff much bigger than the immediate impact on performance. It is the one and only way to improve the real driving force of higher performance, attitude. Choices. You might often hear buzzwords like empowerment and ownership in a business context, but what do they mean in a practical sense? To salespeople who define themselves as being responsible for a critical business objective, bootstrap salespeople, it comes down to the attitude of always having, and having to make, choices. Since everything you do and say has an impact on how your clients and prospects view you, it's best to accept the idea that you have a huge element of control over what happens next. Bootstrap salespeople have an attitude of never being out of the decision zone. If you are not reviewing your options and making conscious decisions, you are not thinking, you are not taking risks, and you are not using your intellect to work out what your options are. Day one mentality. Do you remember your first day of a new sales responsibility? The day when you had nothing left to do except go out there and meet your customers and prospects face to face, or pick up the phone to find new people to pitch? In most cases, you were likely to have some history to work with, existing clients, perhaps some live opportunities in the pipeline, hopefully a few leads to pursue. One thing is almost certain. You looked at your area of responsibility to some extent as a blank canvas. What were your opportunities, your roadblocks, your options? They were wide open. Bootstrap selling relies on never losing that fresh perspective, the thought that every day in sales is day one. Yesterday's triumphs and disasters do not define what will happen tomorrow. If you were meeting your biggest, most established customer for the first time, what would your objectives be? How would you assess your opportunities and risks? If someone else took over your sales responsibilities tomorrow, how would they move forward? Bootstrap selling does not mean you change direction every day, but it does demand that you focus on your goals and regard almost everything that you do as another tool to achieve them. Perspective. A final element of the bootstrap selling attitude is the realization that selling is not a war. The world is happy for you to succeed. You sell and get paid for solving the pains of your customers. I once heard this summarized by a very experienced sales leader in a way that I have copied countless times ever since. He said to a problem client, "All we want is to discover if you have a problem that we are well suited to resolve. If you do, and if it makes sense for us both economically, then we should probably work out how to do it. If not, then it makes sense for us all to do something else with our time." That perspective and technique are at the heart of bootstrap selling. Chapter 1. A Bootstrapping Profession. Selling is at heart an entrepreneurial activity, which is to say it is a bootstrapping profession. If clients and prospects do not need your help to redefine what their problems and pains are, they do not need salespeople. Selling calls on you to go into your market and introduce an element of disruptive, positive change in the lives of your clients. In virtually every successful relationship you have with a client, you bring value to them because you guide them from having an understanding of a general surface pain, a symptom that something needs to change, to a deeper awareness of the business impact of that pain. Finally, you assist with the realization of the personal effects that come from having this pain resolved. This is what bootstrapping entrepreneurs do for their customers. They transform perceptions, identify the impacts of the status quo, and assume responsibility for adding value by challenging the status quo. It's what bootstrapping salespeople do too. I wrote this book to help salespeople who don't yet think of themselves as bootstrappers to think a little differently about who they are, what they do, and why they're in the game. I wrote it to help them make a difference in the lives of others.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.